Hello, Bee here, and welcome back to Biology. You may have heard that breakfast is the most important meal of the day, but do you know why? You may have guessed that your body needs to start the day by taking in the nutrients it's going to need to produce energy. You'll likely use a great deal of energy as you go through the day, whether you are doing schoolwork, playing sports, or even just hanging out with friends. As you probably know, the energy your body needs comes from the food you eat. But what happens to food once you eat it? How does your body absorb the molecules it needs and get rid of the ones it doesn't? And which molecules get turned into energy? Those are the questions we'll explore today. But before we get started, let's look at our goals for this lesson. By the end, you'll be able to explain the steps of digestion in humans, explain the function of the excretory system, and describe how your nutritional choices can affect your digestive health. Remember that a system is a complex set of many parts working together, and the digestive system is no exception. This system can be thought of as a long, tube-like structure that is responsible for breaking down food and absorbing nutrients. Where do you think digestion begins? Digestion begins in the mouth. Food is chewed and mixed with saliva, which contains enzymes such as salivary amylase to break down complex carbohydrates. The physical act of chewing also helps start the process of digestion, as it breaks food into smaller pieces with more surface area. This makes the pieces easier to digest once they are swallowed. The chewed food then travels down the esophagus and into the stomach. But remember that food and drink are not the only things that enter our bodies through the throat. The air we breathe also comes in, either through the mouth or nose, and shares the upper part of this pathway. When the esophageal sphincter is closed, air will travel down the trachea, or windpipe, to the lungs. However, when a bite of food is being swallowed, the sphincter closes the windpipe, sending the food down the esophagus to the stomach. Once swallowed, the sphincter reopens, allowing air to once again pass through to the trachea. If the sphincter does not open and close properly, food can end up in the trachea instead of the esophagus, which causes choking. Once in the stomach, the heavy lifting of digestion begins. This occurs with the help of hydrochloric acid, also known as stomach acid, as well as many different enzymes. Many of these enzymes are produced in the pancreas, a small organ located near the stomach. Protease enzymes, such as pepsin, break down protein molecules into amino acids. These amino acids will be used to make new proteins that your body needs to build muscle and tissue. Lipase enzymes break lipids down into fatty acids, and amylase enzymes break carbohydrates down into glucose. The fatty acids and glucose will be used in cellular respiration to provide energy for your body. Do you remember learning about cellular respiration in a previous unit? In the mitochondria, food and oxygen are used as reactants in the steps of glycolysis, the Krebs cycle, and the electron transport chain. Water and carbon dioxide are released, but the most important product is ATP, the energy carrier molecule. The food molecules that respiration begins with are obtained during digestion. Most of the nutrients needed for cellular respiration are not absorbed in the stomach, but in the small intestine, where the partially digested food goes next. The remaining waste is then moved into the large intestine, where water and electrolytes are absorbed. Any material remaining is then compacted into feces and eliminated through the anus. Two additional organs play a key role in digestion as well. the liver, and gallbladder. The liver produces bile, a greenish-yellow fluid that helps break down fats and remove waste products from the body. Bile is stored in the gallbladder until it is needed for digestion. When fat enters the small intestine, the gallbladder releases bile into the intestine, where it breaks it down into smaller droplets that can be more easily digested and absorbed by the body. In addition to producing and releasing bile, the liver also plays a key role in the metabolism of nutrients absorbed from the digestive tract. It helps regulate blood sugar levels, processes and detoxifies substances such as drugs and alcohol, and synthesizes and stores vitamins, minerals, and other nutrients. Pause the video for a moment here and label the parts of the digestive system on the diagram in your notes. Now that you know the different parts of the digestive system, you may be wondering how food particles move from one part to the next. Gravity obviously helps a bit in the early steps of moving food from the mouth to the stomach through the esophagus, but what then? A process known as peristalsis is responsible for moving materials along the digestive tract. Peristalsis is simply the repeating, rhythmic contractions of the esophagus, stomach, and intestines. The stomach is a smooth muscle that contracts in this squeezing motion involuntarily, which is why you don't notice or have to think about this process at all. Not all of the molecules in the food you eat are needed by your body, and other, sometimes toxic waste, is produced as a result of the chemical processes that go on to digest your food. So your body needs to have a way of getting rid of these waste products. This is the job of the excretory system. It consists of several organs, including the kidneys, bladder, ureters, and urethra. The kidneys are the primary organs of the excretory system and play a vital role in filtering waste from the bloodstream. The kidneys filter waste from the blood and produce urine, which is then transported to the bladder, where it is stored until it is eliminated through the urethra. One of the most important toxins that is eliminated by the kidneys is urea, which is a byproduct of protein metabolism. Testing the amount of urea in the blood can be a good indication of kidney function. Let's take a closer look at how the kidneys function. Within the kidney are smaller units known as nephrons. The nephrons separate toxins from the blood and send the toxins into a tube that will combine the toxins with water to form urine. Each kidney contains hundreds of thousands of these structures, allowing our bodies to remove all unneeded and harmful waste and keep only the materials that our body will use. A hormone known as ADH, which is produced in the hypothalamus of the brain, controls how much water the kidneys can pull out of the blood. If the blood has a low water content, more ADH is released, which causes the kidneys to replace water back into the blood. This means water can't be used to filter out toxins as quickly. When the water content in the blood is higher, less ADH is released by the brain, allowing the kidneys to use more water and filter out waste more efficiently. If you think way back to the first units we did in biology, you hopefully remember those four important macromolecules we learned about: lipids, nucleic acids, carbohydrates, and proteins. We've learned today that your body has specific enzymes for digesting these molecules because it needs the building blocks they are made of to produce energy and make the structure of your body. This means that the choices you make about what you eat matter. Eating a diet low in protein means your body won't have the amino acids it needs to build your muscles, skin, bones, etc. Not having enough or the right kind of lipids and carbohydrates means that your body can't produce energy effectively. The goal is always to keep your diet balanced, making sure your meals include some of each group of macromolecules. Have you ever seen a food advertised as being high in fiber? Foods such as fruits, vegetables, and whole grain breads have lots of fiber. Fiber is a type of carbohydrate that our bodies can't digest to make energy, but it is still required to help digest other types of food. It helps materials move smoothly through the intestines and provides food for the good bacteria living in your gut that helps break down the food you eat. What else should be included in a healthy diet? What about something you drink? Water! Even though water has no calories and does not directly provide energy, it is one of the most important substances that keeps your digestive system running. Waste can't move properly through the large intestine to be expelled without enough water content, so being dehydrated can cause constipation. Water also allows the kidneys to function correctly. And if your body senses dehydration, it has to release more ADH, which prevents the kidneys from using water to remove toxins. Many of the chemical reactions that process the nutrients from your food also require water as a reactant. So grab some water and drink up! As we went through the lesson today, we saw how the digestive system breaks down food to give our body the building blocks it needs, and how the excretory system eliminates unnecessary and harmful waste. In the lesson PDF, you'll explore the function of the kidneys in more detail and look at what can happen when the kidneys don't function correctly. Next time, we'll look at another important system in our bodies, the immune system. Until then, remember that biology isn't just science, it's the way of life. Hey!